Today, I'll start the series of videos about the Gaggiuino Gen 3 installation in my Gaggia Classic E24, and I think I'll have to split in at least two videos because there's a lot of preparation work. It's gonna be easier for you to get ready to install, avoid mistakes, and the start and stop process when you forget to buy a tool, a component, or a nail polish, for example. And yes, you heard well, you may need a nail polish. It's something that delayed the installation of my time of flight, but I'll cover that later. Bear in mind that if I'm talking about nail polish, this video will be very detailed. It's gonna be boring, but it's the homework that you should have done before installing your Gaggiuino Gen 3. And I tried to summarize everything that I think you could have forgotten, or some parts in the instructions that for me was a bit obscure. I'm not a technician in Espresso machines, I'm not a software developer, so I hope that these instructions will be more clear for you after seeing my video. So, despite being boring, watch this video, take notes, use the checklist that is linked in the description, and if you didn't buy yet, your PCB, screens, the 3D printed housings, and other long lead items, I also recommend you to watch my video about how to buy the Gaggiuino parts. Carlos here. And also in the description. Before we start, I need to remember that in this installation you will change the high voltage wiring in your machine. So on top of the shock and fire hazards, if you mess up, you may have short circuits, you may fry your PCB and screen, and everything that you do is at your own risk. With all that said, let's start with some preparation work. If you did the 9-bar spring mod, or if you bought one of the machines in the United States from Whole Lotta Love that comes with the 9-bar spring, you will have to replace it by the 15-bar spring or add some washers. In the Gaggiuino webpage, there are some instructions on how to add the washers, the specs. It's a simple modification. You will need some wrenches, and I also recommend you to have a kit of wrenches or an adjustable wrench, because you will also need to remove the steam tube if you want to have more space to install the thermocouple, or because you may have to redo the wiring and it's a bit tight inside the machine. In my installation, I removed the screws that fix the boiler to the frame and also the steam tube, so that I had more space to make the consolidation tubing for the time of flight, to install the pressure transducer. You will have to cut the hose, install a T, and then connect another tube to the pressure transducer, and also for the wiring, it's useful to have more space to connect the stuff inside. For the people in the US, consider grounding your machine. It's a safety measure, it's to avoid shock hazards. And for people in Europe, if you have one of these machines with the eco mode, you will have to remove the spring from the power switch. And if you have any doubts, check my video about the power switch mod. You don't need to do all the modification, you don't need to install that wiring in the video, but you will have to remove the spring, and in that video I show you how. Now let's talk about wiring. Stock wiring is not recommended if you have a Gaggia Classic Pro 220 volts with eco mode. You will have to do the custom wiring modification, and it's a bit more work, I think, but it's a much cleaner installation. It's easier to understand and easier to organize the cables later, which will also help you to keep the cables, the AC cables, far from the DC cables, which avoids interference in the electronics. It's an issue that I had with the first modification that I made, the Gen 2, in my Gaggia Classic 2006. And today my recommendation is to do the custom wiring, even if you don't need to. If you're doing the custom wiring, my recommendation is to buy new cables and connectors as prescribed in the Gaggiuino website with different colors. It's going to be easier for you to organize, to understand where everything is going to. And in my case, I tend to reuse the cables and connectors. It's a personal issue. I have a problem with waste, especially wires and connectors. It's a noble material. But if you are not comfortable, or if you want to do a more professional installation, buy new wires and connectors. It's worth, okay? And then what are the things that you may forget if you just read the instructions? One, I think it's very useful to have the flag connectors because they make an angle, a 90 degrees angle, and it's easier to route the wires in some cases. But to crimp the flag connectors, you need a special crimping tool. Then you will have to buy this tool. I'll also leave the link in the description and in my checklist, but bear in mind that you can use the regular spade connectors, but it's going to be easier and cleaner if you have the flag connectors, especially for the wires that will be connected to the power socket. Again, you can reuse the flag connectors that come stock in your machine and solder or use one of those bare crimp connectors. But if you're doing everything new, you'll have to buy the flag connectors and the crimping tool specific for flag connectors. Still on the connectors chapter, I think today that bare crimp connectors are better than soldering. In my case, I didn't have one specific for thicker wires, and I soldered some wires in the machine. It's okay, but I don't think today that it's the best method. So plan for it, buy the bare crimp connectors. There are different widths that you may need, but they are cheap. You just need a crimping tool that you use for almost all the crimping work and those additional connectors. And of course, you will need insulation. You can use electric tape, self-fusing tape, or heat shrink tubes with a hot air gun. This last one is my preferred method, but pay attention to the specifications. You need to use the silicone heat shrink tube that resists to high temperature, especially in the connections that will be close to the boiler. But no matter what is the insulation type that you choose, always have some electric tape at hand because it's useful in some areas or when you forgot to put the heat shrinking tube before making the joints, or because you may use it to protect the cables. For example, when I installed the cables for the ST-Link and I need to send it to the outside of the machine in the frames, it's a bit sharp and I could damage the cables. So I added some electric tapes to protect those very thin cables for the ST-Link. I think I'll never need to use again the ST-Link. Now I can make the updates over the air using Wi-Fi, but in case, I don't know, Wi-Fi is not working or there's any software conflict, I can still flash the PCB using the ST-Link. And for the cable management, consider buying some hooks for the cables and some double-faced tape. Also some extra zip ties. The ones that come in the kit from Pickoff are not sufficient for the cable management, in my opinion. And it's very important, not only for the organization, but also because remember that you need to keep very well separate the AC from the DC wires to avoid interference in the electronics. Then I would try along the installation to organize your cables and keep all the AC cables far away from the DC. For the hardware scales, what are some points of attention? If you have a Gaggia Classic Pro, you may have to cut a piece of your drip tray. And for that, you will need a masking tape, a drill bit, 10 millimeters for plastic or wood, or a step drill bit. And for the finishing, you will need a hobby knife and some files or a Dremel. Then to assemble the hardware scales, you will need super glue and some baking paper and a metallic plate because you will need to install the magnets flush. And then one of the techniques that is recommended is to use the magnet plate to attract the magnets, but you will need the baking paper to avoid the magnets getting glued to your metallic surface. If you saw my video about the hardware scales installation in Gen 2, you will remember that it's a bit annoying to install the magnets, to glue the magnets. If you don't want to end up with super glue on your fingers, it would be useful to have some ceramic tweezers or something that is non-metallic to place the magnets in the small pockets for the hardware scales, but it's not mandatory. Regarding the 3D printed parts, it needs to be very precisely printed. So if you're not buying from the official vendors, if you're printing yourself, you need to make sure that you have the adequate gap, especially between the load plate and the load cell housings. Then my recommendation is to use in the slicing an option that will print the inner, outer and inner layers in the sequence. This will ensure a better precision on the dimensions on the outside and also in the holes inside the pieces. If you're not printing yourself, if you're ordering from someone else rather than the official vendors, remember to tell this person that they need to use this option. And I also recommend you to buy a spare. In my case, I inverted the poles in one of the supports for the scales. I had to reprint. Even after checking and rechecking, I made this mistake. It happens, so it's better to have a spare. For the time of flight, it's a simple installation. I just wanted to highlight that you will need a nail polish to conformal coating the board, and you will need a small brush to apply the nail polish. The one that comes with these products is for the nails. It's too thick, so not easy to apply. And you cannot just apply on the whole board. You need to preserve at least the LED and the sensor. So it's easy with a thin brush. And then if you don't want to end up with nail polish on your fingers, you may improvise. You may buy a small vise from AliExpress, or you can 3D printed one. I'll leave a link in the description in case you want to 3D print. It's not mandatory, you can improvise with some hanging clips for clothes. And just to mention three last useful stuff. One, you will need an M4x10mm nut and screw for the SSR to fix to the frame. And I think this is the kind of stuff that we forget. Two, Kapton tape is useful to attach some wires to the frame, and you will need in some of the cases. Third, sometimes you don't do the things in the best sequence, or you need to reduce something, and then instead of removing and reinstalling, for example, an SSR, it may be useful to have a ratchet wrench and a long hex key. I used when I was removing the cables. There's a black box housing for the cables in the E24 that was blocking the way. I wanted to check if I could remove it or not. I wanted to cut the wires, and then I loosened the screws to be able to maneuver this black box. And in this case, it was very useful, this long hex key. It's, again, not something that is mandatory, but it's useful to have it around. In terms of preparation, I think that's it. Read the instructions in the Gaggiuino website, get familiarized with the electrical diagram and the instructions for the custom wiring. Read my checklist that is linked in the description, and in 2 weeks' time, I'll come back with the full instructions for the installation. See you in 2 weeks.